It's a big bang acquisition from the Aditya Birla Group. Hindalco Group company Novelis has acquired US-based downstream producer Aleris for $2.6 billion. To understand the deal and understand what it means for the group as a whole, I'm joined by Mr. Kumar Mangalam Birla, the chairman of the Aditya Birla Group. Mr. Birla, at $2.6 billion, 7.2 times EBITDA, there are fears that maybe you've paid more. How do you look at the valuation?
I think those fears are completely unfounded. The way to look at valuation is to see other comparable transactions in the same sector. I would say that 7.2 is, if not very reasonable, in fact, on the lower side in the sector, especially given the quality of the asset as well.
And if I look at Aleris as a company, I mean, why would you say that it's a perfect fit for Novelis and Hindalco? I understand they are into value-added products and that will give it a boost. But going forward, what's the kind of synergy benefits that you see between the two companies?
So Aleris is in the same space as Novelis, which is aluminium rolled products. Novelis is the world leader globally, the largest in every market that it is in. Aleris is a very high-quality player. Large player, revenue of about $3 billion, 13 very high technology manufacturing sites across Europe, the US and China. It gives Novelis a couple of things. It gives Novelis a stronger franchise in the auto market. Therefore, it solidifies its position and deepens its position in the auto market. As you know, auto is using more and more of aluminium from the point of view of lightweighting to be able to meet environmental norms. It also gives it a foray into some new sectors, for example, building and construction.
Yes.
Very interestingly, the very high margin aerospace sector, where you have customers like Bombardier, like Boeing, for example,
all marquee
Airbus,
names, yeah,
which are very marquee names. So these come along with the transaction. This transaction is completely financed on the balance sheet of Novelis, and I think it's hugely value creating.
Mr. Birla, I mean, how does Novelis finance this transaction? I mean, what are the options that Novelis is looking at in terms of financing? It's a pretty large deal.
So, without getting into too much of complexity, the deal size is $2.58 billion, as you said. About $775 million is through equity, which will be paid for by Novelis.
Yeah.
The balance is debt of Aleris that Novelis will take over. And the idea is to, at some point, soon after the takeover, refinance that debt. We believe that Novelis can get the debt at least a couple of 100 basis points, if not even lower as compared to Aleris. So I think it's all off the balance sheet of Novelis, which is the point to underline.
So Hindalco doesn't play any direct role
Hindalco
in this
plays
transaction?
No role at all in the financing for this transaction.
And so it would be, I mean, so if I look at Hindalco's expansion, the inorganic plans that it has, I mean, when it comes to Aditya Aluminium Mahan, I mean, those will continue as planned. I mean, there would be any change in those plans, right?
So I don't think there's any change in track there. I think that what is important is that as a whole, Hindalco is becoming a larger and larger value-added player in terms of its proportion of portfolio that's, towards
value
the value-added segment, which is the intent. That's been the stated ambition of Hindalco even 10 years ago, which is why the foray into Novelis at that point in time.
And for the Hindalco group as a whole, I mean, if I look at it that way, the proportion of value-added products will increase considerably post this deal?
It does. It takes the value-added part to about 70%+ from being practically zero about 10 years ago. It also makes the whole combined, the Hindalco combined, after this transaction happens, the largest aluminium company in the world, in fact, with a turnover of about $21 billion.
Mr. Birla, Aleris's deal with a Chinese company didn't make the cut because of security reasons. How do you make sure that the deal goes through with Novelis? I mean, so there are no hurdles along the way.
So I don't know about the previous transaction. That's best asked to them. But I think in our case, it's very clear. Novelis has been around for a very long time. Novelis provides employment to almost 7,000 people in the US, in Canada. The intent is to grow. We have no intention of shutting down any facility or rationalizing. The idea is to create more jobs. No, hardly any overlap in terms of portfolio, in the sense that the only common vertical is auto.
Yeah.
And if you look at auto and you compare the use of aluminium in auto with the use of steel in auto, aluminium still is such a small player that there is no competitive threat at all, mm-hmm. Because of which these permissions might get held up.
Okay. And if I look at Hindalco as a whole, I mean, what would be the combined capacity and where does it put Hindalco in the global pecking order?
So, if you think about it from a more Hindalco perspective, Hindalco has VAP or downstream products of about 400,000 tons per annum. Novelis is about 3.3 million tons per annum. This acquisition, which is Aleris, is about 1 million tons per annum. And like I said, this acquisition makes Hindalco, if obviously you take into account the primary metal production as well, the largest aluminum company in the world.
How do you expect this acquisition to play out when it comes to the domestic market? Because the Indian auto segment is also changing quite fast. I mean, electric vehicles could become the norm in some years. I mean, you see a big demand coming up from the Indian auto sector per se?
So, I don't think that this transaction is pivoted on the Indian market and auto in the Indian market. I mean, that's for the future to tell us,
sure,
how EV picks up. But I think some elements of technology that Aleris gives us, for example, for the building and construction segment in India, would be invaluable to Hindalco. So, I think there's huge value creation all over.
Mr. Birla, I mean, looking back at the Novelis acquisition, that was almost 11, 12 years back, that you actually went in with a $5, $6 billion acquisition, which was a big one at that point in time. I mean, do you think Novelis acquisition played according to the script you had? And over the next 3 to 5 years, what's the kind of upside that you see from Novelis?
So, yes, the answer to that is very much it played to the objective that we had. Like I said, the objective was to have a much larger portion of, sure, mm-hmm, downstream products as compared to having upstream. And Hindalco at that point in time was only an upstream player. Novelis is a very valuable company today. It would be valued at about $10 to $12 billion. I think interestingly, we invested $6 billion, and within the first 4 years, Novelis had given back about $3 billion by way of reduction in capital. So hugely accretive, very valuable franchise, and above all, it's a global leader.
In fact, this deal also comes amid fears of a trade war. I mean, have you also factored that in? Because how do you ring fence Novelis, Aleris, make sure that there are no fresh hurdles along the way?
So in this business, it's largely a localized business. So you don't have too much of transportation or material. Therefore, we don't think that the tariffs and the tariff tussle that is happening just now will have any impact at all on Aleris.
In fact, it's almost like double delight for you, because at the end of the day today, I mean, DOT has also given the approval, the much awaited approval for the Vodafone Idea merger. What does it mean for you? Because I'm sure you've been waiting quite, because at the end of the June was the kind of a deadline you had. So what does it mean for you, the green signal?
So it's obviously been a very complex process. But I think from our point of view, it's a new chapter in the telecom business. It's a much larger business. We're talking about 400 million subscribers. And we're really excited at the potential of it.
And going forward, I mean, you expect the merger to play out, start playing out very soon? I mean, how does it happen? What happens next?
So I think a lot of internal stuff would precede anything that's seen from the outside.
Okay.
But at the end of the day, the idea is to give the customer a much stronger value proposition.
Yeah. But the competitive, the landscape that is there, the kind of tariff bloodbath that you've seen over the last few months. You see that continue, I mean, going forward?
So that's a little bit of crystal ball gazing. I don't want to get into that, and difficult to say. But I think that one of the ideas behind this merger was to be able to survive and thrive in this very competitive market.
Because you had a projected a market share of around 36% for the combined entity. I was looking at some of the analyst reports, and they say that over the next 1 or 2 years, they see the combined market share go down to 30% because of the kind of competition that we are seeing. Do you share that kind of a concern?
So again, very difficult to say, but you know, when you have a very large capacity and market share, I think that there is some you know, some logic to saying that you might lose market share, but on the whole, a very powerful base to grow from.
And duplicity of functions, people doing the same role in 22 different circles, how do you make sure that there is as little disruption as possible? Because obviously there are fears that people are going to lose jobs, I mean, which is something that happens in a big merger like this.
So, you know, these are things that have been planned for the last several months.
Sure.
And are very much part of any merger, whether large or small. And I don't think that we are really worried on that front.
Turning to the cement sector, I mean, UltraTech, I mean, we see a lot of activity in the cement sector. I mean, what's the kind of targets that you have for UltraTech? But this is by far India's largest cement company. And the kind of revival that we are seeing in demand, how do you see UltraTech playing out over the next 12 months?
So targets can be on many dimensions.
Sure.
But I think that the idea basically is to solidify our position as the country's largest player by far. We are looking at an acquisition potentially. Of course, the courts will take a final view on that. We are always looking at servicing customers better and providing them with complete solutions as opposed to just a few bags of cement.
Mr. Birla, it's almost a year since the IBC came into effect. What's your take? Has the law played according to the script? Do you think it should have done more, or are you happy with the way things happened in the last 12 months maybe?
So firstly, it's important to recognize the fact that IBC is a reform, not just a reform, but a very deep reform.
Sure. Mm.
So when we think about reform, we think about GST, we think about DMON. No one talks as much about IBC. I think IBC has changed the face of the Indian entrepreneur forever. Having said that, I think there are some loose ends or some rough edges in a new legislation, as would be the case with any new legislation, that need to be ironed out. Other than that, I think IBC is very much a step in the right direction.
And finally, Mr. Birla, now you have completed a $2.5 billion acquisition. Going ahead, for the group as a whole, will acquisition remain one of the prime ways to grow business, or you would also be, it will be a fine balance between organic and inorganic?
If you look at the last 10 years, Hindalco has also grown substantially on the back of organic expansion.
Sure.
Be it Aditya or Mahan, Smelters, Utkal, Alumina. But I think the real question to ask is, what creates the most value? Mm. And on the basis of that, you need to decide whether inorganic or organic growth is the way ahead.
Thank you for speaking to us.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.